Well, good morning and a warm welcome to our service this morning. Welcome to our members of congregation, any visitors, of course, and anyone who's watching online. We're always glad to have you as part of our service. Creche facilities are available during the service for anyone who wishes to make use of them. And if you'd like to learn more about your Christian faith and how you can become a full member of the congregation, please speak to our minister. Then during the week, the following, the BB Friends and Parents Evening will be held tomorrow night, 7 p.m, and everyone will be made very welcome at that. Then Tuesday sees the walking group walking from Coors Corner, the upper part of the Newton Abbey Way, down towards Mossley Mill. And as usual, you meet in the church car park at 10 a.m. Wednesday night, congregational committee will meet. The committee will meet at 8 p.m. and the business committee will meet before that at 7:30. Every Sunday is, of course, an opportunity to support each other in prayer. And please let us know if you would like to pray for anything by filling in one of the request cards or by speaking to an elder or to the minister. And these are all today's announcements for your consideration and prayers.
Out of the depths we cry to you, Lord. Lord, hear our voices. Let your ears be attentive to our cry for mercy. If you, Lord, kept a record of sins, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness so that we can with reverence serve you. We wait for the Lord. Our whole being waits, and in his word we put our hope. We wait for the Lord more than watchmen wait for the morning. Put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. God will redeem you. Let us worship God. There, do you want to squeeze in here? Are there more, Jeff? A couple more coming. It's good to see you. Do you think your parents are cool? Do you think they're hip and with it? They know all about the latest things? Shall we test them out to see if they're actually cool today? I know, girls. Now, sometimes one of the things that grown-ups aren't very good at is knowing how to text. Because, one, they don't know how to read text on their phone sometimes. But also, they don't know what modern text mean. Because if I show you a picture, what's that? It's a smiley face. Do you know the word for a picture like that? No, very good. I don't know if the grown-ups... Grown-ups, put your hand up if you know the name of what that is, not what it's a picture of. Couple of hands. Oh, they're cool. If you're putting your hand up because it's an emoji, you're hip and with it. Because, you know, sometimes younger people don't send words and texts. They send pictures. I don't send pictures. They send emojis, don't they? Is that right? Have you ever sent an emoji? Why would you send that one? Because you're happy. That's right. What about this one then? Now, any of the grown-ups know what it means though? What's this one mean? And boy, you have to be careful when you're selecting emojis these days. They have all kinds of meanings. Anybody know what this one is? Thirsty. Okay, that's our treasurer. He thinks that one means thirsty. I think that's the opposite of thirst in some ways. What do you think, Riley? That's quite right. I'm feeling silly. I'm feeling goofy. Isn't that right? That's very good. All right. You got 1 point. Grown-ups, not so much there. What's the next one? What do you think this one is? Any of the grown-ups know what they think this one is? What do you think, Ruth? Don't know. Actually, do you think she's right with that? Don't know. What do you think it is? What do you think? It's not bad. That's the same kind of thing, isn't it? Don't know, wondering. You are quite right. That's what it means. To be perplexed. Kind of, And what about this one? No, hang on. Let's put the grown-ups. What do they know? Any of the grown-ups know what this is? Not sunburnt? What do you think? Are they right? They're saying angry. What do you think it is? It is. All right. They actually got that one right. That's well done for them. Should we give them a round of applause? Come on. They got one right. They don't often get these things right, but we'll give them one today. What's this one? Let's see if the grown-ups know what it is. What do you think? Susan, you said shock. Anybody else said anything? What do you think it is? What would you see? What would you say if you saw that one? Surprise. That's right. It's to show surprise kind of thing. And oh, no! And what about this one? Now, what do you think, grown-ups? Is it a picture of the minister? Any guesses from the grown-ups first? Well, let's see if they have any ideas. Angelic, I hear somebody shouting out. What do you think it means?
You're an angel.
That's not far off it, actually. That's not bad. What it means usually, if they're saying that, it's about being kind or pleased with something good has been done. So you could have all these kind of conversations with just these little emojis. And what about this one? Now, any of the grown-ups think they actually have a good idea what this one is? Now, I've all said sad. Do you think they're right to say this one means sad? What do you think?
Sad.
Yeah. Everybody's agreeing. You're quite right. That's an emoji, and maybe you don't want to send that one, would you? Because it maybe doesn't feel very nice to be sad. Because we might want to be goofy, or we want to be happy, and we might want to feel that we've done something good. But sometimes we don't want to feel like this. In fact, you know, sometimes what we do is we might not even want people to see that we're sad if we are. And if something has annoyed us or something has worried us, we don't want to tell people. And we all keep it inside. Do you ever do that? Because I don't want people to know. No, I'm going to be quiet. I don't want people to know I'm sad. Well, you know, you don't need to do that. In fact, sometimes if you keep everything inside, it's not very good for you. Today, we're remembering a story about Jesus. And he had heard that his really good friend, Lazarus, was sick. Really sick. And they said, Jesus, please come as quickly as you can. But by the time Jesus got there, his best friend had died. And Lazarus had two sisters, Mary and Martha. And how do you think they felt? They did. They did too. And how do you think Jesus felt about his best friend? Yeah. And there's a little tiny verse, John chapter 11, verse 35. And in the English Bible, it's sometimes known as the shortest verse in the Bible. It's only two words, and it's simply this: Jesus wept. His best friend had died, and he cried. And he wasn't worried that other people could see it. He was sad, and other people could see he was sad too. Because sometimes when things are bad, it's okay to be sad, and it's okay to let other people know. But the good news is that Jesus knows just what it's like to be sad. And any time we feel sad, we don't have to keep it to ourselves, but we can share it. We can share happy times too, but we can also share sad times with our families and with God, because God understands how we feel. And we never have to hide anything away. And we can share who we are, whether we're happy or goofy or silly or kind or sad, with God, because God loves us completely in the good times and the bad times. So let's say a prayer. Dear God, thank you that Jesus was just like us. He had a family and grew up learning about the right things and the wrong things and making friends and helping out with the chores around the house. But thank you that even though Jesus is so special, he still understands us. He knew what it is to be tired or angry or sad, or to relax with his friends, and most of all, to be kind. Help us to know that when we pray to you, you hear us and understand us completely, because we pray in Jesus' name. And he taught us to all say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And we're going to sing a song now, Connor. Right. Do you want to stand up? Sunday, and there's going to be a job for you to do, so I hope you can help me out next Sunday. Will you do that?
Yeah.
I'll tell you what it is next week. Have fun in Sunday Club.
A reading from John's Gospel. Now a man named Lazarus was ill. He was from Bethany, the village of Mary and her sister Martha. This Mary, whose brother Lazarus now lay ill, was the same one who poured perfume on the Lord and wiped his feet with her hair. So the sisters sent word to Jesus, Lord, the one you love is ill. When he heard this, Jesus said, This illness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed where he was 2 more days. And then he said to his disciples, "Let us go back to Judea." "But Rabbi," they said, "a short while ago the Jews there tried to stone you, and yet you are going back." Jesus answered, "Are there not 12 hours of daylight? Anyone who walks in the daytime will not stumble, for they see by this world's light. It is when a person walks at night that they stumble, for they have no light." After he had said this, he went on to tell them, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I am going there to wake him up." His disciples replied, "Lord, if he sleeps, he will get better." Jesus had been speaking of his death, but his disciples thought that he meant natural sleep. So then he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead, and for your sake I am glad I was not there, so that you may believe, but let us go to him." Then Thomas, also known as Didymus, said to the rest of the disciples, "Let us also go there that we may die with him." On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die. And whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied, "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who has come into this world. Thanks be to God."
A prayer of confession. Let us pray. When we set our mind to flesh, forgive us, O God, and reorientate us to see the way of the Spirit, of life and of peace. When we make decisions that divide and dehumanize, when we support systems of oppression through our silence or sponsorship, when we choose these ways of death, come, Spirit, and bring life and peace. When we act without compassion or consideration, when we make no room for the needs of others, seeking only selfish desire, when we choose these ways of death, come, Spirit, and bring life and peace. When we speak words of hatred and discord, when we condemn or misrepresent with unwise words and stories, when we choose these ways of death, come, Spirit, and bring life and peace. As we journey with Mary and Martha now in the Gospel and the story of Lazarus, help us to look to your resurrecting love, for we pray in your name. Amen.
After Martha had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been there with Mary in the house, comforting her, noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take the stone away, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odour, for he had been there for 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. When he had said this, Jesus called in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth round his face. Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. Therefore, many of the Jews who had come to visit Mary and had seen what Jesus did believed in him. Thanks be to God.
Let's pray. God, we live in a world with so much death. There is destruction and pointless destruction and lives cruelly lost. We're used to death, but today you give us a story of life. So by your Holy Spirit, speak to us as the gospel confronts us, so comfortable with death that we would know what life looks like. Amen. It was the third anniversary of the first COVID lockdown last week. I think it was the 23rd of March. 3 years. For so many people, it was just kind of, really? 3 years have passed. It seems so quickly, and yet also like a lifetime ago. And there were lots of people who were reflecting on it. I mean, with friends, some people were discussing things, and of course there were public discussions. Discussions about that year that felt lost to so many, the ongoing repercussions of the isolation, the impact on kids in school, the development of toddlers, the economic impacts that reverberated around the world, the continuing investigations in the news into rule-breaking and corruption also reminded us of how bad situations may bring out the worst in some people. And there were jokes, chatting with friends about how people went mad for toilet roll and banana bread, along with all those useless things that you ordered online when you were in lockdown and were bored looking for something to do. The Manse turned into a TV studio, the amount of stuff that's sitting in there. and the fad for open sea swimming, one that never held any appeal for me. I've noticed that my friends who got into that don't get into the water quite so often now. But there was a real mix of emotions in the discussion and humour. But as a minister this week sitting in some homes, I also heard anger and disappointment at things lost, at the behaviour of others, of plans made for years that could never come to fruition. And there was grief. Grief for lives lost, for ongoing health concerns, and the legacy of long COVID, the loss of opportunities and moments with loved ones to be with them in times of sickness and infirmity and dying. How do we process these things? I don't know how you felt or if you noticed this kind of stuff this week, but when we look back through these years when there was such a massive change in our society, when I stood here by myself in the church, none of you were here, and everyone was so isolated. Does our faith relate to these things? To these moments when life is turned on its head and it feels that nothing can ever be the same again? The Jesuit priest James Martin was writing this week about this particular gospel reading for Sunday and the temptation for congregations to try and speed through John's gospel. No offense to Margaret and Ruth, because when we got to this page, they were saying to me, "Are you sure you want to read all of this? It's a long reading. We had it in two parts." But in a world of 60-second TikToks, clergy are uncomfortable in case you start to shuffle in your pews and get bored and lose attention, because clergy don't believe you have enough attention span. The clergy are wrong. But worse, if we give in to that temptation to just live with snippets of the Gospels, Martin points out that we miss out on the depths of such texts, especially today, that speaks about your life. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Judeans who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. There's a writer, a Christian writer, Debbie Thomas, wrote about this gospel during the lockdown. She wrote this: "When Jesus cries, he assures Mary and Martha not only that their beloved brother is worth crying for, but also that they are worth crying with." A disembodied faith, a religion that doesn't take in sweat and tears and grief, is not Christian. Your faith is not a list of facts to learn, a creed to recite, or a confession to sign. It is the living realization that God is present with us. Jesus, at his most human in the Gospels, and no more so than this passage today, helps us to see two things. They're like the two sides of one coin. On one side is this: that we live with the understanding that God knows us, cares for us, is with us. That grief you felt at the loss of a loved one, the despair that grabbed at your soul when those dearest to you became ill, breaks God's heart also. Do you realize this? God is with us. Emmanuel is not some schmaltzy Christmas song. It's a living reality. How often do we need to remember that in a time of someone's grief or pain or distress, the most important thing isn't a specially prepared statement about grief or the perfectly written sympathy card. And maybe you have found yourself standing in the shop looking at rows of cards thinking, which is the right one to get? And you think, no, that one's too corny, or that one's too schmaltzy, or this whatever. There is no right card. There never will be. There are no perfect words to say in those times. In fact, your words might even make the person angry in their grief. But that's not the point. It's because they know that you know about them, that you're present with them. That's what's important. That your presence is there, even if silence is all that is voiced. And that's important. And remember, that is how God has been, is, and will be with you whenever you are grieving or in despair. But the flip side of this, this living relationship, recognition that God is there with us, even when we feel at our worst, is that we're called to practice that same compassion. Christ, the pattern for our lives, the one walking with us, showing us the way to go in life and act towards others, shows us right now what faith looks practically. You want to know how to live out your Christian faith in the world? Look to this story. Because if your beliefs about God and others lack compassion, then it's not Christian. It's just you hiding behind your own prejudices. You know, when you see these stories sometimes about the issues, the moral issues that seem to connect Christianity to the general public's awareness, particularly say the issue of abortion, and people screaming and shouting outside family planning clinics at vulnerable women going into them seeking advice or support. I study theology. I actually understand the complexity of the issues around the debates. I understand the theological positions that some of these people may hold. What I can never understand is their lack of compassion. It's not Christian. If you have no compassion in your beliefs, that's not Christian belief. I loved how Debbie Thomas, as I was reading her own reflections during lockdown, she finished with this: during these last weeks of Lent, as we prepare for Jesus' own death and resurrection, I hope that Jesus' tears can keep us tender, open, humble, generous, and brave. What a beautiful way to describe our calling as Christians. To be tender, open, generous, and brave. What a witness to a world lost in its anger and grief and despair. Because we worship a Lord who doesn't simply leave us to these things, nor avoid the complexity of our emotional lives, but leads us through them to hope. Good Friday is coming for all of us. An open grave awaits, but it's not the end. Life will come, for the God who weeps with us is the one who will also lift us up. Resurrection is coming. Amen. Let us pray. Loving God, you are with us, and you do not leave us. In our grief and despair, you are attentive to our cry. In our waiting and watching, you are present. God, in your steadfast love, we anchor our hope. We pray for all who find themselves in the depths, whether it is despair or debt or too much work and too little time. Whatever their circumstance and need, we turn to you.
Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God. Be still and know that I am God.
For all who find themselves waiting, wondering about what next, whether it is a choice about next steps, worrying about their next paycheck or meal, whatever their circumstance or need. God, for all who find themselves watching, perhaps feeling bound, whether it is a fear of stepping out or of moving on. Whatever their circumstance and need, we turn to you. God, you care for all your children. And so we wait and think of all those who are journeying from death to life, from grief to healing, from despair to hope. There are those we recognize on the journey, and so many that we do not know or cannot yet see. Whatever their circumstance and need, we turn to you.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where the streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be. Every blessing you pour out, I turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be. Blessed be your name. blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name.
God of the living and of the dead, unbind us and call us forth into your world to live by the Spirit, rejecting the ways of death and instead conforming to the way of the Spirit. May we bring life and peace and compassion to wherever we are sent. And the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and abide with each one of you, now and always. And all God's people said, Amen.